chochote utataka nitakupa ma.
Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. It's your girlfriend Ilungu back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe. This video is going to be in two parts, and today we're going to be reacting to Is Life Fair? What is the Reason to Live by Omar. So without wasting time, let's get into the video.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So Sheikh Saad, we were together in Malaysia 2 days ago, alhamdulillah, and now we're here, alhamdulillah, back in Baltimore. I'm not going to say which one's nicer, but alhamdulillah. You know, and he was just asking me if he took some of my topic, and he did take a lot of my topic actually. But at the same time, I think in this whole concept of fairness, and it's good because I actually have a lecture tonight, inshallah ta'ala, about why does God do certain things. And so I don't have to address that part of the lecture right now, inshallah, or the topic right now. But I think if we address it purely from a seerah perspective, meaning studying the biography of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, then we learn a lot about the concept of fairness and how fairness was viewed by the Prophet, peace be upon him, and by the companions around him. Number one, is fairness objective or subjective? Is it an objective term, and is it a subjective term? For those of you that don't know what that means, would everyone in here be able to agree on what fairness is? Would we be able to agree on that? In fact, no two people would be able to come together and agree upon a fair salary for everyone in the world and what would be fair for every person in the world. It's an extremely subjective term, which makes it a very difficult subject to address. And what we realize when we study this topic of fairness as a whole is that not only is it subjective, but it really is a mindset. It's completely a mindset. And for many people, it's a mindset of entitlement, meaning what? Life's not fair because I didn't get this and I didn't get that, and because this didn't happen for me and that didn't happen for me. And unfortunately, you know, a lot of times it says a lot about our priorities in life and what we think about. Because a lot of times you don't have your faith crisis, you don't start thinking about life not being fair because of the children that are starving in Africa or in Syria or whatever it may be. You start thinking that life's not fair when you didn't get into med school or when you didn't marry the person that you wanted to marry, right? That's when you start questioning God, and that's when you start questioning the fairness of life. That's a greater crisis to you than the other stuff that was going on in the world. And you started using the other stuff in the world because now you're depressed and now life wasn't fair to you. And you're complaining, and while you're complaining, you get to a point sometimes where you accuse God himself, Allah himself, of being unfair, which is the discussion tonight that I'm not going to touch. But it shows you that it's a concept, or it is a mindset of entitlement. And you know, subhanAllah, when you study it, truly from, you know, Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said something very powerful. He said that the people that accuse Allah of not having adl, of not being just, and of life not being just to them, it's not that they want life to be fair, it's that they want life to be unfair in their favor. I thought that was very powerful, subhanAllah, when I read that. He said, you know, and think about that. You don't really need text to justify that statement. You know, you want to be rich, you're not really complaining about life being unfair when things are going well for you. Okay, when you have your house, when you have your car, when you have your career, when you have your education, when you have your money, it doesn't matter that life's unfair. You can very easily quote the ayat of the Quran about patience and those types of things and say, yeah, you know, Allah's taking care of them and there's a greater purpose for them. Alhamdulillah, we should all say Alhamdulillah and we should all be happy. It's not a problem when it's unfair in your favor. It's a problem when you feel like you're getting the bad end of it. And you know, again, it's so subjective that I'll share with you all a personal experience. I had someone in my office, in my masjid, 3 years ago. And I try not to give many details because thanks to YouTube, I've gotten in a lot of trouble over the last few years of telling stories without saying names. And then that person watches them on YouTube and I get in trouble. So I'll try not to be too detailed in what I say. But one of the things that took place, subhanAllah, over 6 years of being imam in New Orleans is that I was exposed to the real problems that we have as a community, and also how shallow and superficial we are as people. And you know, so I had this brother in my office and he's crying. And I was wondering why he's, you know, I thought something tragic happened in his life. and you know he lost his job or something happened. But you know, instead, what he's talking about, he's saying that you know, life's been tough recently. And he lives in a really nice house, mashallah, great car, very rich, very wealthy, has several kids. And he says, life's been tough recently, you know, and you know, things are getting really tough. And he said, but I don't know, you know, sometimes I question Allah. And I said, oh, you know, a'udhu billah, what's going on? And he starts telling me, he says, you know, every year I take my kids to Europe for a vacation. And he said, this year I don't have enough money to take my kids to Europe for a summer vacation. What am I supposed to tell my kids when they come to me and tell me, Dad, why aren't we going anywhere this summer? That was his faith crisis. To him, that was life being unfair. And I'm sitting there looking at him like, and what else happened? But to him, that's life being unfair. And what does that show you? Again, it is a mindset. There's a very powerful hadith. The hadith is in Sahih Muslim. It's narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu. If my memory does not fail me, I think it's from Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ. Verily, he has succeeded who has submitted himself. Sheikh Sa'ad talked about the Islam part. Submitted himself. It's a prerequisite to everything that comes next in the hadith. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ وَرُزِقَ كَفَافًا. And he was given enough. Kafaf means to be given just enough. And listen to the last part of the hadith. وَقَنَّعَهُ اللَّهُ بِمَا أَتَى. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala convinced him or satisfied him with what he gave him. So what does that show you? That these two things that were just mentioned don't always come together. You might be given enough, but you're not convinced with what you have and you're not satisfied with what you have. So the Prophet ﷺ said, the one who really succeeds in life and the one who's really happy in life is the one who has submitted himself, who has attained that peace through Islam, was given enough, and Allah satisfied him with what he gave him. Allah convinced him. Qana'a is literally to be convinced. It's not rida, it's not necessarily satisfaction or contentment. It's literally to look at yourself and say, alhamdulillah, yeah, you know, this is good, this is great. And when you look at the Prophet, peace be upon him, the Prophet, peace be upon him, went through many stages in his life. And that's why I say we can justify this through a seerah perspective. And Imam al-Qurtubi in particular, rahimahullah, he says that the Prophet, peace be upon him, was tested with every phase of life. He was tested with wealth, with ghina. He was rich. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was rich. After he married Khadija radiallahu anha, until the time that he received his revelation, he was a rich man. He became a wealthy man. And he passed the test of wealth. That's what he said. Wa ahsana fi ghina'i. He passed the test of al-ghina. How did he pass the test of al-ghina? Because when he was rich, what did he do? He freed slaves. He took care of orphans. He didn't become arrogant as a result of his wealth. His personality did not change at all. Right? The Prophet, peace be upon him, did not change as a result of being wealthy. And in fact, those were the words that Khadija radiallahu anha shared with the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he came down from Hira, right? La yukhzika Allahu abada, Allah will never humiliate you. Why? Because look at all the great things that you do. You know, you do well by orphans and your guests and your neighbors and your family. You do well with people. You do what you're supposed to do. And Khadija has been rich longer than the Prophet, peace be upon him. She knows that most rich people are snobs. They don't do that stuff. He passed that test. Then Imam al-Qurtubi said, Allah stripped him of everything and tested him with poverty, with al-faqr. Absolute poverty. The Prophet, peace be upon him, experienced poverty in its worst form. Not only did he experience poverty from a financial perspective, but you know, truly, as Sheikh Sa'ad mentioned, everything was taken away from him. Everything was taken away from him. His wife, his uncle, his protection, everything. His support from his tribe, his land, his home. I mean, everything was taken away from him. And he said that the Prophet, peace be upon him, passed the test of poverty. أَحْسَنَ فِي فَقْرِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. He passed that test. Why? Because he showed a beautiful patience. He demonstrated truly, sabrun jameel, a beautiful patience. Not only was he patient because he had to be patient, he demonstrated a satisfaction with God, a contentment with God. And the only thing he cared about in those moments of poverty was God not being displeased with him, was that poverty not being a manifestation of Allah's displeasure. Because sometimes you question yourself in poverty. And that's a mistake in mindset. That's a mistake in the way we think sometimes. It's called the prosperity doctrine. Almost every religion in the world has some form of the prosperity doctrine. Okay? Whether it be the Eastern religions and Hinduism, the caste system, or even in evangelical Christianity today, that when God loves you or whatever divine presence loves you, you're well off. And when God doesn't love you, then you're not doing too well. But Islam preaches the exact opposite. Right? When Allah loves you, He tests you. When Allah loves you, the Prophet ﷺ, he said that Allah withholds the world from you the way that one of you would withhold water from one who has a fever. Meaning what? Someone who's sick in that particular sickness, he thinks that, or he wants that water. You know, I won't say if you've seen a woman in delivery, right? Sisters, those of you that went through delivery, and brothers, those of you that saw women going through delivery and were terrified and thought that your wife would kill you, all right? At that moment, you know, whenever a woman really wants to drink water, and, you know, I remember being put in that situation. I don't want to go too far into detail, right? But my wife really, really wanted water, and the nurse said no. And my wife looked at me like, are you going to listen to the nurse? Like, this is a pretty awkward situation for me right now, right? She really wants that water at that moment. Really, you know, when you're sick. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah withholds the dunya from you the way you would withhold water from your saqim, from your person who's sick, who has that fever at that moment. Meaning what? It goes back into addictions. Don't expect Allah to feed your dunya addictions. And it's for your own good. Right? So the believer recognizes, even in his poverty, that when Allah withholds, He gives. He gives you something greater than what He withheld from you. And that's exactly what happened to the Prophet, peace be upon him. Then he said that the Prophet, peace be upon him, was put in a state of al-kafaf. Al-kafaf means to just have enough. Literally, just enough to survive. And the Prophet, ﷺ, his kafaf, his just enough to survive, would have been considered poverty by any one of us. What the Prophet lived through, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, would have been considered poverty for any one of us. He never had two meals a day. Wouldn't we consider that poverty? Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, we never had two meals a day, except that one of them was dates and water. Meaning what? It wasn't really a meal. We just had a few dates and water. Months would pass without any smoke coming from the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning he didn't have a cooked meal. He never enjoyed fine bread, a fine loaf of bread. That's poverty to us. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's house, his hujr, you know, his hujurat, the apartments that the Prophet ﷺ lived in were so small that when he would make sujood, when he would prostrate, he would tap Aisha on the legs so that she could move her legs up so that he could have enough space to do his sajda, to prostrate. If any one of us saw that, we'd say that's poverty. To him, that was enough. And you know what's amazing is that the Prophet ﷺ, he was satisfied with what he had. But you know what? Some of the companions thought, hey, that's not fair. And so Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he walks in the Prophet ﷺ's house and he sees the Prophet ﷺ getting up from his bed, and his bed is just some branches stuffed with leather, and you know, and he sees the marks on the Prophet ﷺ's back, he starts to cry. And the Prophet ﷺ says, why are you crying? And what does Umar say? He says, I've seen the palaces of Kisra. I've seen the palaces of Kisra in Persia and of Caesar in Rome. I've seen what other kings live like. And you deserve better than that. What's Umar telling the Prophet ﷺ? This isn't fair. Right? You shouldn't live like this. Life's not fair to you. You shouldn't have to live like that. You're the greatest man in the world. You're the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And all of us would agree that we would want him to live a better life in this world. Right? We would have wanted for him to have more ease. And it's really interesting, because put yourself in the Prophet ﷺ's shoes at that moment. The Prophet ﷺ did not say to Umar, well, yeah, you guys should probably do something about that. Right? Now that you're upset about it, why don't you guys go build me a house or something? The Prophet ﷺ, he says to Umar, أَلَا تَرْضَى, aren't you satisfied? أَنَّ لَهُمُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَنَا الْآخِرَةَ, that they have the dunya, they have this materialistic world, and we have the hereafter. With complete conviction. Look, the Prophet.
There's a famous saying, and I'm sure you guys are familiar with it, saying, you don't appreciate something unless you've come from nothing. It's like, it's the poor that appreciate more when they get something. Even just getting like a ball to play with, they're going to be grateful for that. But you, it's going to be like, but I have one of these, why am I getting one again? and we should really check ourselves. If I had to ask you, we were talking like maybe on Instagram or something, and I asked you, is life fair? How would you describe that?